Please, take a seat. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Please take a seat. Good afternoon, and welcome to the State Department. President Yoon, Mrs. Kim, it is a great pleasure to have you here with us today. Now, some of you may have heard this and actually seen it, but last night, President Yoon brought down the house at the state dinner. Singing American Pie. So, Mr. President, I want you to know, we have two great American musical giants with us here today, Herbie Hancock and Diane Reeves. So, if you feel moved to deliver another performance, don't let the music die, Mr. President. Evan and I are delighted to join Vice President Harris, Second Gentleman Doug Emhoff, in welcoming all of you here today. And I know we're joined by an incredible group of friends, colleagues, particularly I want to salute the members of Congress who are here. President Yoon just came from delivering an extraordinary speech to a joint session. It has been 70 years since the United States and the Republic of Korea formed our alliance, making official a bond that was forged by Korean and American soldiers in the crucible of war. Kachi Kapshida, we go together. That was their motto. And indeed, they lived and fought and died shoulder to shoulder. From the beginning, American and Korean leaders understood that our alliance was about more than our two nations. President Eisenhower, speaking to Congress, said that it was an affirmation of our belief that the security of an individual nation in the free world depends on the security of its partners and constitutes another link in the collective security of free nations. It was also a way to create space for Korean and American entrepreneurs and innovators, scientists and artists, governments and citizens, to use that security and their freedom to improve our societies in real ways. And who, looking at how far we've come since that time, would question whether our partnership has lived up to its promise? We see the extraordinary emergence of Korea in virtually every domain around the world, not just as the strongest of security partners for the United States, but in science, technology, the arts, culture. We have never wavered in our commitment to our mutual defense. We've invested in our shared prosperity and competitiveness, and we have decades of mutual growth to show for it, including in the industries and technologies that are shaping the future, from quantum computing to renewable energy to biotech. We've invested in the foundation of our strength, our democracies, while also deepening ties to our partners who share our commitment to freedom, to equal opportunity, to human rights, to the rule of law. That's why President Biden convened the first two summits for democracy, the second of which was co-hosted by President Yoon, and it's why Seoul will take up the mantle now in leading the third summit for democracy next year. As we think about all the ways that our countries go together, it's easy to take for granted our closeness, to see as somehow inevitable the parallel arcs that U.S. and Korea have traced over time. But the reality is this: the friendship between nations, like all friendships, ultimately comes down to the actions of individuals. And it's here that I'd like to express our enormous gratitude to President Yoon. At a time of tremendous challenge to the international rule of law and the United Nations Charter, to our democracies, indeed to our planet, Mr. President, your principled leadership has helped bring us even closer together and has made Korea a global pivotal state. And that's to the benefit of Koreans, Americans, and indeed, to people around the world. Now, it's not just our leaders who are committed to deepening our friendship, but our people. starting with Korean Americans. This year also marks the 120th anniversary of the arrival of the first Korean immigrants to America, 100 or so men, women, and children who arrived on Honolulu shores. Today, the extraordinary contributions of generations of Korean Americans are woven into the fabric of American society, from the sweeping histories of Min Jin Lee's novels to the explosive flavors of David Chang's dishes to the exceptional service of diplomats right here at the State Department, like one I'd like to mention today, Julie Chung. Julie was just 5 years old when, in 1977, her family moved from Seoul to California. She didn't speak a word of English. Her dad got a job on the drafting floor of an engineering company. Her mom worked nights washing dishes in a restaurant. Julie's mom went on to become a librarian and a church deacon. Her dad later designed a heating system to prevent O-rings from freezing on space shuttles. That's what had caused the Challenger explosion, allowing NASA to restart the space missions. And Julie joined the first cohort of Pickering Fellows at the State Department, which encourages the service of historically underrepresented minorities. Today, Julie's dad's engineering company is working on technology that will help the United States, Korea, and other partners who are joined in the Artemis Accord return astronauts to the moon, including the first woman and first person of color. And Julie is the United States ambassador to Sri Lanka. If these are the threads that are connecting the United States and Korea through a single family, just think how rich, how deep the ties are that are binding our nations together. So, President Yoon, Mrs. Kim, all of our distinguished guests, I ask you to raise a glass with me. And we'll even find a glass to raise. To all the ties that make our nations go together, and to all the places that they'll take us, Mr. President. And now it's my great pleasure to turn it over to the Vice President of the United States.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Secretary Blinken, Ms. Evan Ryan, for hosting us here at the State Department, and to the members of Congress who are here, including Speaker Emerita Nancy Pelosi, Chairman Menendez, and Chairman McCall. Thank you each. And there are many members of the President's Cabinet who are here, and I thank you as well, including all of the leaders from the Korean-American community and all of those who believe in the importance of strengthening the ties between the United States and South Korea. So, Mr. President, it has been a pleasure to be with you these last couple of days. Mrs. Kim, it has been a great pleasure for my husband, the Second General of the United States, to also spend time with you and to co-host the luncheon this year. I thank you, Mr. President, for the warm welcome you offered me when I visited Seoul last September and when the Second Gentleman was there to attend your inauguration in May of last year. President Yoon, you campaigned for office on a promise to strengthen the alliance between our nations, and you have delivered. My visit to Seoul, as well as this state visit, are a demonstration of the expansive agenda between our two nations, and that our alliance is truly a global one, an alliance that is leading on the most pressing issues of our time. In Seoul, you and I outlined steps to strengthen our collective defense in the face of aggression and provocations in the region. We renewed our commitment to a free and open Indo-Pacific, and the freedom of navigation, and the free flow of commerce. I thanked you then, as I do now, for standing strong in the face of Russia's unprovoked aggression in Ukraine, and for standing up for international rules-based order. We have strategized together on a clean energy future, on resilient supply chains and advanced technologies. We have consulted on democracy, and I thank you for your speech today. We have discussed gender equality, and of course, we have talked about our mutual excitement about space exploration. In fact, earlier this week, you and I advanced our space cooperation during a visit to Goddard. And on a personal note, we share a background as prosecutors and a mutual commitment. Yes. And our mutual commitment, therefore, to the rule of law, to justice, and to accountability. President Yoon, you have set South Korea on a path to economic and global success. And together, the Biden-Harris administration, with your administration, has set our alliance on a path forward to continue to deliver security and prosperity for our people. On the issue of security, the alliance between the United States and South Korea was forged in shared sacrifice, as you so eloquently described earlier today. During the Korean War, Americans and Koreans fought and died together to defend against aggression. We fought together for peace and security and for freedom. More than 36,000 American service members paid the ultimate sacrifice for this noble cause, as did 137,000 soldiers from your country. During this state visit, we once again solemnly honor that shared sacrifice. And in a demonstration of our enduring commitment to our collective security, today, more than 28,000 American service members stand guard in your country to continue to deter and defend against shared threats. It was my great honor and privilege to meet with some of them when I visited the DMZ last year. They have demonstrated extraordinary dedication, skill, and discipline, and they proudly stand shoulder to shoulder with their South Korean counterparts, representing the best of America's commitment to our alliance. We also share a mutual commitment to prosperity. Over the course of the last three decades, South Korea has become an economic powerhouse, as demonstrated by the fact that your country, as you mentioned earlier, represents the 10th largest economy in the world. And there are now 16 South Korean Fortune 500 companies, some of the most influential in the world. And South Korea is a global leader on advanced technology, semiconductors, and the clean energy economy. Together, our alliance is driving economic growth around the globe. And to that end, under President Biden and our administration, we have made historic investments from the Inflation Reduction Act to the CHIPS and Science Act. We are investing billions of dollars to revitalize American manufacturing, which means companies, including South Korean companies, will create good-paying jobs here in the United States. President Biden and I are particularly proud that since we have taken office, Korean firms have invested more than $100 billion in the United States, much of which will accelerate our transition to a clean energy economy. For example, SK and LG are investing billions in electric car battery plants in Georgia. I see the senator from Georgia is here. Michigan, Ohio, and Tennessee. Hyundai will manufacture electric cars in America. Samsung is constructing a $17 billion chip factory in Texas. Chairman McCall. And earlier this month, I visited a Qcells plant in Dalton, Georgia, which manufactures solar panels. And thanks to the Inflation Reduction Act, that plant will triple its solar panel production. Altogether, these investments will create tens of thousands of American jobs, address the climate crisis, and build prosperity for the people of both our nations. South Korea and the United States, as the Secretary has mentioned, also share strong cultural and people-to-people ties. K-pop bands, they topped the billboards in the United States, including BTS, who I had the great pleasure of meeting and inviting to my office in the West Wing, and to the great pleasure of my niece, I must tell you. I also think of the Emmy Award-winning TV shows like Squid Games, which I will confess Doug and I binged-watched at home over a series of weeks. And I think of the actress, Yoon Ya-jung, who I met in Seoul last year when I convened groundbreaking South Korean women. She is the first Korean to win an Academy Award for acting. These are examples of the cultural ties and the intertwined history between our nations. And we take pride that the United States is home to the largest Korean population in the world outside of the Korean Peninsula. And we recall history. There are those who came to Hawaii, the senator from Hawaii is here, to work in agriculture in the early 20th century, those who came after the Korean War, and those who arrived in recent decades to study in American universities and to build businesses here. There are now nearly 2 million Americans of Korean descent, including luminaries like Johnny Kim, the astronaut who we visited with at Goddard earlier this week, including members of Congress who are here, including Representatives Andy Kim, Young Kim, Marilyn Strickland, and Michelle Steele. There they are. Who are with us today. And this list also includes a member of my family, my sister-in-law, Dr. Judy Lee, who is also with us today. So I will conclude by saying to you, President Yoon, across all of the areas I have just mentioned, your leadership has enabled further progress for our two nations. And our administration is grateful to you for strengthening our ties and serving as a steadfast ally and partner and friend. This is a decisive moment in our world's history, a critical moment, an inflection point in many ways. And at a time when autocracy and aggression are all too prevalent, your leadership is critical. I know that we share a vision of the world, a secure, prosperous world, with strong alliances and strong rules and norms. And I know that all of this will benefit from the relationship that we have with the Korean people, between the American people and the Korean people, and people around the world indeed will benefit. In 1953, as the Korean armistice approached, President Eisenhower wrote to President Rhee in Seoul. He wrote, and I quote, "There cannot be independence without interdependence." So true. He went on to say, "And there cannot be human liberty except as men recognize," and I will add women, "that they are bound together by ties of common destiny." President Yoon, this remains true today. I believe our nations and our people are increasingly bound together in a shared future and a common destiny. We are more interconnected and interdependent than we have ever been. And that, I believe, is to the benefit of all of humanity. So I raise a glass. To the enduring friendship between our nations and the friendship between us as leaders. Cheers. Thank you. please.
Camera. My camera.
Thank you very much. And I will now introduce President Yoon.
Thank you. Harris 부통령님,
Vice President Harris,
그리고 M. Hof 부부님,
Second Gentleman
Blinken
M. Hof,
장관님,
Secretary Blinken,
라이언 비서관님,
White House Cabinet Secretary Ryan, and distinguished guests.
세계 외교의 중심부인 이곳
I extend my gratitude to you for inviting me
감사.
To the heart of global diplomacy.
두려움 없는 전사인
With Vice President Harris, a fearless fighter, and with strong supporters of the ROK U.S. alliance,
함께하고 있으니까.
It feels as though there is no obstacle that we cannot overcome.
아, 여러분들과 함께 있으니까 정말
it
마음이
is truly
든든합니다.
Reassuring.
이 건물의 이름이
I heard
Harry
that the name
Truman
of this building is the Harry S.
그랬습니다.
Truman Building.
제 용산
President Biden gifted me
Biden
a plaque with President Truman's words that I keep on my office desk. He granted me this plaque last year in Korea.
놓여져있습니다. 모든 책임
And the plaque reads, the buck stops here.
The buck stops here. 이 문구를 보면서
This phrase reminds me
자유와
of the devotion and responsibility
책임을,
for freedom and democracy.
책임입니다. 여러분도 아시다시피
As you're well aware,
트루먼 대통령은
President Truman
1950년 6월 25일 공산군이 침략했을 때 즉각 미군을 투입하고 안보리를 소집해서 유엔군을 보내주신 분입니다. 지난 70년간 한미 동맹은 참전 용사들의 희생으로 가져진 그 토양 위에서 역사상 가장 성공적인 동맹으로 발전했습니다. 대한민국이 전쟁의 폐허에서 국제적 위상을 가진 국가로 성장한 것은 바로 이 동맹의 힘이었습니다. 어제 저와 바이든 대통령은 한미동맹의 발전 방향에 관해 다양한 유익한 협의를 가졌습니다. 저는 이를 바탕으로 대한민국 국민에 대한
I plan to develop our alliance in a way that expands practical benefits for the peoples of both our countries. Our future will be brighter than the past. Our two countries will build peace through strength and lead the solidarity of freedom to promote peace in East Asia and the rest of the world. We will further strengthen our solidarity and cooperation in cutting-edge future technologies, including semiconductors, quantum, artificial intelligence, space, and cyber.
그리고 양국의 젊은 인재들은 서로를 통해 배우며 자유, 평화, 번영의 인태지역을 만들어 나갈 것입니다. 글로벌 현안에 대해서도 양국은 더욱 긴밀히 협력해 나갈 것입니다. 해리스 부통령님과 블링컨 장관님을 비롯하여 오늘 이 자리에 모이신 참석자 충분히
are the mainstays of the global comprehensive strategic alliance between the Republic of Korea and the United States. We look forward to your continued support as the ROK-U.S. alliance marches forward. Thank you very much.